لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، صلى الله عليك يا سيدي ويا مولاي يا رسول الله وعلى أهل بيتك المعصومين الأبرار الميامين المظلومين المضطهدين، والسلام عليك وعلى ولدك المظلوم أبي عبد الله الحسين يا رحمة الله الواسعة ويا باب نجاة الأمة يا غريب يا مظلوم يا عطشان كربلاء، ما خاب والله من تمسك بكم وأمنا من لجأ والتجأ إليكم. يا ليتنا ويا ليتنا كنا معكم سادتي فنفوز والله فوزا عظيما. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. في بيوت أذن الله أن ترفع ويذكر فيها اسمه، يسبح له فيها بالغدو والآصال، رجال لا تلهيهم تجارة ولا بيع عن ذكر الله وإقام الصلاة وإيتاء الزكاة، يخافون يوما تتقلب فيه القلوب والأبصار. آمنا بالله، صدق الله العلي العظيم. والسلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته.
الله سبحانه وتعالى، He very clearly distinguishes in the Holy Quran different groups of people. In the verse I just recited to you, the one I'm sure you all know about, in which he says that there are certain houses, indeed the houses of the prophets and the messengers, that Allah has permitted his name to be raised up and remembered and extolled. And in these houses, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to be praised, or is being praised continuously, bil-ghuduwi wal-asal, night and day. And these houses are comprised of individuals who the Holy Quran says, لا تلهيهم تجارة ولا بيع عن ذكر الله, that there is nothing that will divert their attention from the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nothing will take them, that will draw them towards tijara, meaning business, transaction, anything related to the life of this world, and that will be a source of accumulation for them, such that it will take their attention and it will divert it away from the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These individuals, the people chosen by Allah, are those who they fear. يَخَافُونَ يَوْمًا تَتَقَلَّبُ فِيهِ الْقُلُوبُ وَالْأَبْصَارِ. They fear a day, on the day of judgment, in which the hearts will quiver and the eyes will roam, or they will turn in every direction. They will be bewildered. Why? Because you will be called to account. Now I ask you, in this one verse, if we go like right to the very end, and we must ponder on the words of the Holy Quran deeply, because it speaks to our basic nature, that whenever something, God forbid, happens that is bad, that is tragic, that shakes us to our very core, how do we feel inside? One, you feel your heart start to beat very, very quickly, do you not? Your heart starts to race because you now feel the panic that is inside of you. And at the same time, if someone were to look at your eyes, or even if you were to at that moment just think about your own state, what it's like, your eyes would be darting in every direction. Why? Because at that moment of panic, you are looking for a way out. You're awake, looking for a solution. You are looking for some salvation that will give you tranquility in your life. And yet, these believers, the ones who are strong, ones who are never deterred from the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they know that it is the goal for a believer that on that last day, on the day of judgment when we stand in front of Allah, that should be the day when our hearts won't quiver. Our eyes won't be darting around in every direction, because we will have known that we lived our lives the way we were supposed to. And that now Allah's promise will come true and He will send us towards where our final abode is going to be. Yet to get to that point is not easy, because the vast majority of the people in the life of this world are those people who will sell their religion, and they will do so, why? Because they want to earn some comfort, something they consider to be indispensable in the life of this world. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, now those people who were defined as the ones living in the houses or the members of the house where His name, Allah's name, is extolled, like the name, like the household of Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad alayhim as-salatu wassalam, those are unique individuals chosen by Allah. And yet, everyone else falls into a separate category. We are the ones who, in the course of our life, we need to find a way that when the moment of difficulty comes, we know how to act with respect to that difficulty and how to deal with the tragedy and the suffering that surrounds our life. And the Quran gives us many, many examples of this. You all know that in the fifth year after Hijrah, what happened? That the Muslims of Medina, they received word that the armies of Quraysh are advancing upon Medina, and that they are coming with a large horde, a very big army, comprised of many different tribes that have decided that this growing nation of Islam should not be allowed to persist, should not be allowed to advance, and that we will assault its very heart in Medina. And so what happened? They built the trench, you all know, and you all know the historical details of the fight that occurred at the Battle of Khandaq or the Battle of Ahzab. The Holy Quran, it describes the state of the people. The people in Medina who were digging the ditches, amongst who was Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. And they say about our beloved Rasul, that it is related, Imam Ali alayhi salatu wa sallam, he would say that if there was ever any trouble, any difficulty, any emergency that arose upon us, we only had to look at Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, because he was the first to go and confront it. He was the first person there. He was the first person who was up on his feet, for lack of better terms, and ready to engage that difficulty rather than recoiling back. And so now the people of Medina, they see this large army confront them, face them. And the holy ayah, the ayah of the Holy Quran, what does it say? It says, وَلَمَّ رَأَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الْأَحْزَابَ, when the believers, they saw the ahzab. Now, in this verse of the Holy Quran, they say it is the believers. The verse says, when the believers saw. It doesn't say, وَلَمَّ رَأَ الْمُسْلِمُونَ الْأَحْزَابَ. It didn't say muslimun. It says mu'minun. That means, again, this classification of this ayah is for a believer. It says, when the believers saw the ahzab, saw the hordes coming towards them, towards Medina to fight, قَالُوا هَذَا مَا وَعَدَنَا اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ وَصَدَقَ اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ, they said to each other, that this is what Allah had promised us. And truly the promise of Allah and the promise of His Rasul are true. And now what does the verse say? وَمَا زَادَهُمْ إِلَّا إِيمَانًا وَتَسْلِيمًا. That it only served to increase their faith and increase their submission in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My dear brothers and sisters, why is it that we fear something? Because we fear a loss of its consequences, because of the consequences of what is going to occur. And because of those consequences or the loss that is going to occur, it generates a fear inside of us. And here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, be assured that what I have said is going to come true is what you must believe in to be the surety of life. That is the yaqeen. And that's why the Quran says, wa'bud rabbaka hatta ya'tiyaka al-yaqeen. Worship your Lord until certainty comes to you, until death arrives. And know that Allah is truthful, that whatever He says will indeed absolutely come to pass. And if you are sure on that, if you are sure that where you are going is the everlasting abode promised by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Allah says, I will increase your iman and I will increase your submission. And I will do so such that you will feel the weight of that moment to be lifted off of you. We know this. And you see this in the characteristics of those people who stood by Al-Imam Al-Husayn alayhi salatu wassalam, that we are here. Even if you look in the Quran, that when Fir'aun threatened the magicians who had stood up to battle against Musa alayhi salatu wassalam, and Musa alayhi salam's staff became a serpent, and it overcame all of their magic, whatever they had done at that moment, what happened to them? They fell down into prostration and they said, Amanna bi Rabbi Musa wa Harun. We believe in the Lord of Musa and Harun. And what did Fir'aun say to them? That, oh, my magician, you are my magicians. He says, I am going to take you and I am going to put you up on the stakes. I will hammer your hands up on the stakes and I will cut off your legs and your arms and I will punish you, a severe punishment for what you are doing right here. And what was their answer? La dair. There is no reason to worry. Do whatever you want, Fir'aun. Why? Because now we have seen what is the truth. We know what is ahead of us and where we are going. And nothing you can threaten us with is going to scare us off of the path. This is the legacy of those people who have surety in their hearts. And they know where they are going. And when they see the storm arriving in front of their faces, when they see that thing that is going to potentially shake their very being, they say, هَذَا مَا وَعَدَنَ اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ وَصَدَقَ اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ. This is what Allah promised us. He said that this is what is going to come. And our Prophet promised, our Rasul promised us this. And whatever is the promise of Allah and His Rasul, they will indeed come to pass. And so why do I mention this to you, my dear brothers and sisters? Because in those moments of darkness, and yesterday we sat and we recalled and we talked about maut and death, and because we had experienced these losses, the loss of Sister Sanawar and the loss of Hajja Shabnam Fatima, the mother of our dear Hassan Mehdi, Haj Hassan Mehdi, and the difficulty that the families feel, and indeed that anybody feels when there is a moment of loss like this, yet the Quran again is saying that if you keep your eye on the promise of Allah and that the promise of Allah is true, it will only increase your faith and it will only increase your submission. Now, why submission, my dear brothers and sisters? Why does the Holy Quran say, وَزِدْنَاهُمْ إِلَّا وَمَا زِدْنَاهُمْ إِلَّا إِيمَانًا وَتَسْلِيمًا? We increase them with faith and submission. Is it not that we should be in submission first and then faith? To be a Muslim is the first step, to say I submit to the will of God. And then to say that when my conviction increases that I have become a mu'min. But yet in this verse, it is reversed. That Allah says, we increase them in faith and in submission after that. What a beautiful message he is giving to us. Because there are times in our life, particularly in moments of disaster and pain and trial, that Allah says, I am Qahhar over you. I am the one who controls everything. And that you have no control, so only thing that you can do is to submit to my will. Is to say that you see the final goal and that that is where you are going. And that you know you are going to end up over there. My dear brothers and sisters, this is the type of life that we must live. And not only the type of life that we must live, but how we should have our actions in the life, how we must behave. They say one day, a man came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. And he said, O Rasulullah, he says, can you teach me an action by which both Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and all the people will love me? Both Allah will love me and the people will love me. What a great way to live. In which not only your Lord Creator is happy with you, but everything around you, everyone is happy with you. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, he says, tell me more. The man, he says, make it such that this action, my wealth will increase, that my body will be healthy, that my life will last long, and that when I am raised up on the day of judgment, I am raised up with Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad alayhim as-salatu wa-salam. I would say that that's winning the lottery, isn't it not? I mean, what more can you ask for? Your wealth increases, your health gets better, you have a long life, people love you, Allah loves you, and on the day of judgment, you are raised in the company of Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad alayhim as-salatu wa-salam. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. What does he say? He says, if you want Allah to love you, he said, be afraid of him and make sure don't transgress his limits. Imagine, I think we all know that why is it that we drift away from God? Because the very thing that he told us to do is not transgress his limits, and yet we do. We transgress those limits. And that's why when the storm comes, when the difficulty comes, we are not able to maintain our composure. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, he says, if you want the people to love you, if you want Allah to love you, then don't transgress his limits. Don't sin. Don't do the things he told you not to do, that he prohibited you from. If you want the people to love you, he says, show benevolence to them, rahmah. Be merciful towards the people. And whatever they have in their hands, don't go seeking after it. Ya Allah. So if I see that my brother or my sister in Islam has something that I don't have, don't be covetous of it. Don't be of the people who looks at it and says, oh, I wish I had that. I wish I had this material thing that they have. Rasulullah, he says, no, be benevolent. Be generous, merciful to those, and don't look upon others as having something that you don't have and that you want it yourself. And now, brothers and sisters, Rasulullah, he says, if you want to increase your wealth, you want to have lots of wealth, he says, give zakat. Give lots of sadaqah and zakat. Pay the zakat in the way that it needs to be paid. And not that you're giving just 2.5%. 2.5% is nothing. Not just 20% as in khums. Not just $100 of sadaqah. But whatever you wish for yourself, you give to somebody else. That whatever you would consider to be valuable for yourself, you give to somebody else the same and equal amount. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, he says, if you want Allah to make your body healthy, if you want to have a healthy body, he says, ensure that when someone has a need in front of you, you fulfill the need of that person. And you don't just do it once, you do it frequently, all the time. Anyone has a haqq, anyone has a need in front of you, you go and fulfill their needs. Rasulullah, he says, if you want to have a long life, you have the wealth now, you have the health, and you want to have now a long life, he said, make sure that you act properly with regard to your relatives, your kin. Make sure you have silatul rahm, that connection with your loved ones, your relatives. Don't break off. And there are actually many riwayat, hadith that speak about this, that the key to a long and a peaceful life is to have good relationships and reaching out to your relatives, to the rahm, to the kin, to the relatives. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wasallam, what does he say? He says, if you want the last thing, the thing that we are all waiting for, huh? The thing that, as I say this, let me remind myself that on that day, on the day of Ashura, one man came to Imam Hussein, huh? He was the Mawla of Aba Dhar. He was the attendant of Aba Dhar. And he says, Yabna Rasulillah, will you give me permission to go and fight on the day of Ashura? Imam Hussein looked at John, Mawla Aba Dhar. John, he says, Yabna Rasulillah, I know my skin is dark. I know my fragrance is not good. But will you allow me to go fight and give my life so that my blood can be spilled defending the household of Rasulullah? Even though I am not worthy, Al-Imam Al-Hussein, how he sent, he said, John, he says, you consider yourself to be fortunate that you were with our family, the Ahl al-Bayt, but it is us who are the one who are honored that you stayed with us, huh? That you accompanied us and are with us in this last moment. When John died and he called to Imam Hussein, As-salamu alayka ya Aba Abdullah, Imam Hussein raced to the battlefield, fell on the body of John. And on that body, he said to him, Ya Allah, make his face filled with noor as he comes to meet you in this next world. Imam Hussein, he said, give him the fragrance of Jannah. Allow him to be raised with Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad alayhim as-salatu was-salam. So we want to be of these people. So when the man asks Rasulullah, that Ya Rasulullah, how is it that we can be raised up with you on the day of judgment? Rasulullah, he says one thing. He says, make sure that you go into sajda a lot and that you stay in sajda. You prolong your sajda as long as you possibly can. Now imagine all of this. All the things that he is telling you, that ensure you want to be wealthy, you want to have a long life, you want people to love you. All of it requires that you give away your wealth. You don't seek the wealth or the possessions that are in other people's hands. You curb your own arrogance and you submit yourself in front of Allah by bowing your head in front of Him, staying in sajda. Sajda is the ultimate position of submission to Allah. And it is not just a position that is physical because your head is on the ground. It is because your qalb, your heart has descended down. Your very ego has been broken in front of Allah. And that's why the believer is the one who acts in this way. I want not to extend too long tonight, but I do want to talk about one particular event. We mentioned very clearly that those who stand facing the enemy or the trial or the difficulty in life, when they see it as the decision of God, as the will of God, as a means by which we can ascend so that we can get to our final position in the Akhirah, are those people that Allah says, وَمَا زِدْنَاهُمْ إِلَّا إِيمَانًا وَتَسْلِيمًا, that we did not increase them except more of faith and more of submission. Why? Because these were the people who were resilient. In the time of Imam Hussein, you all know that when he fought and he gave his life, he stood there with only 72 of his companions, 17 of his relatives, his sons, his nephews, his brothers, the people from the family of Aqil, Muslim ibn Aqil, and fighting alongside of him, they all gave their lives. A few of them survived. Only a few, like Hassan al-Muthanna, survived. And that the men who came out to fight against Imam Hussein, now imagine those 72 men looking at the horde, the enemy that is standing on the side of Umar ibn Sa'd la'anatullahi alayhi, and with what courage they stood and they fought, and with what courage they were resilient and moved forward. We have to face life with this sort of courage. But we also have to realize that in our states, the way we are, we must constantly seek tawbah of Allah, repentance from Allah, because we don't have the resilience to stand on the side of Imam Hussein and to be like those companions. We don't have that resolve. We must be honest with ourselves. Their level of faith, those Sahaba of Imam Hussein, was very high, was very prominent. They were not ordinary men like us. We are not like those sorts of men, but we must strive to be like them. And we must strive to do so by not only being strong, but by seeking repentance. And when I say repentance, I don't mean asking for forgiveness. I mean constantly resetting our course towards the path of Allah. We get diverted, we come back to the path of Allah. We get diverted, we realign our faces towards Allah and the service of Allah. And one event after the demise of Imam Hussein is a very good example of this and almost exemplifies the fearlessness and the strength of Iman and submission in the verse that I had relayed to you in the very beginning. You know that the men who came out of Kufa on the side of Umar ibn Sa'ad were the people of Kufa, 4,000 men before the additional 26,000 or more, some say, had joined the army of Umar ibn Sa'ad. However, you know that there were many men who wanted to support al-Imam al-Husayn alayhi salatu wassalam, like Sulaiman ibn Sard al-Khuza'i. Sulaiman ibn Sard al-Khuza'i, he was from the tribe of Khuza'a. Khuza'a was a tribe from Yemen, but he was known as a great companion of al-Imam Ali alayhi salatu wassalam, along with companions like Musayyab, along with other companions who had been imprisoned by Ubaidullah ibn Ziyad in Kufa and could not be released or were not released so that they could come to Karbala to stand up with Imam Hussein in the fight for truth. So now, as soon as it is found out, as soon as they find out that al-Imam al-Hussein alayhi salatu wassalam is martyred, and the circumstances begin to change. You know that Yazid did not live very long after the events of Karbala. Maybe 2 years he survived. After that, he died. His liver failed, he was a degenerate human being, and he died. His son, Muawiyah ibn Yazid, he assumed the rulership for 1 month, only 1 month. And then he abdicated because he knew that the atrocities committed by his father were wrong. And so he immediately abdicated after 1 month. And they say that the people, the men of his tribe, of the Banu Umayyah, they hated this act of his so much, his denouncement of his father, that they had him killed. So Muawiyah ibn Yazid, the son of Yazid, was also killed by his own family members. After this, they say the people of Banu Umayyah began to fight about who would be the ruler. At this time, it was mainly Marwan ibn al-Hakam who stepped forward. And there were many who would support Marwan ibn al-Hakam to take over the leadership of what they considered to be their nation under their control. In this time, also the men who were held in the prisons of Kufa because of their support for Imam Hussein, like Sulaiman ibn Sard, they were freed. They eventually were released because they felt now that Hussein is dead, that there is no reason. These men came out and they felt great remorse that they were not able to be next to Imam Hussein and that they were the ones who had sent the letter to Imam Hussein to come to Kufa and because of which Imam Hussein was trapped by Yazid in Kufa and martyred on the plains of Karbala, in Karbala. So these men, what did they decide? They decided 4 years after the events of Karbala that they would not remain silent, that they would not accept the Banu Umayyah's regime. And so they sent letters. Some letters were sent to Basra. In Basra, there were many supporters of Imam Hussein. And the letters were sent to them saying that come and join us. We are going to rise up. And not only are we going to rise up, we are going to meet in a place called Nukhayla, Al-Nukhayla. In Al-Nukhayla, the letters were sent out that come join our uprising against the Banu Umayyah to avenge the killing of Imam Hussein. Join us at Nukhayla. It is reported that the letters that went to Basra and that went to other regions to call the people to support them against the Banu Umayyah did not reach in time. So at Nukhayla, when Sulaiman ibn Sard at this point was 93 years old. Now I ask you, at 93 years of age, Imam Hussein is dead. He has gone from this world. He's been gone for years. What reason does Sulaiman ibn Sard need to stand up at 93 years of age? There is no reason at such an age for him to be fighting. Yet they say he goes out and he leads all these men to come up to Nukhayla. And unfortunately, the supporters from Basra do not arrive. And the letters that went to other regions, the supporters do not come. So whatever men gathered in Nukhayla, they say some 4,000 men who had joined, they make their way up in towards Syria to a place called Ain al-Warda. Ain al-Warda is where they meet the armies of the Banu Umayyah. Now the armies of Banu Umayyah are vastly outnumbering them. And not only vastly outnumbering them, they had prepared a march and an assault on Mecca against Abdullah ibn Zubayr, who was also scheming and plotting. So they knew they had a fight ahead of them and they were preparing. And so when Sulaiman ibn Sard and his men come up to meet the Banu Umayyah at Ain al-Warda, they fight for 3 days, my dear brothers and sisters. And during those 3 days, they say that the fighting of these men who were penitent because they could not help Imam Hussein. And it's not because they didn't try. It's not because they didn't want to. It's not because they were afraid or overwhelmed. It's because they were locked in those prison cells and could not be released. They fought valiantly. And after 3 days, Sulaiman ibn Sard was martyred. And many of these men were martyred. These men were called, are now known as At-Tawwabun, the penitent, the ones who are penitent. At-Tawwabun, why? Because when they were freed from their prisons in Kufa, they immediately, what did they do? They gathered all together, they wrote a letter, they gathered all these men who were so remorseful of not supporting Imam Hussein, and they said, we are going to go to Karbala first. And they made their way from Kufa all the way to Karbala. And in Karbala, they fell on the grave of Abi Abdullah al-Hussein. And they said, Ya Aba Abdullah, you called us. You called people to come and support you. We heard your cry and we were not able to come to help you. We were not able to come and lend our support to you, Ya Aba Abdullah. But we are here now. We are going to stand up now. And this is the lesson that I am trying to derive for myself. That yes, indeed, I am not standing there next to Imam Hussein, and that the task ahead of me is very tall and difficult, but that I know where I am going, and that it is not going to shake my faith, and it is going to give me more submission in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that I must continue, that I should not sit back and say my job is done, and that this is for someone else to carry on. No, to be like Sulaiman ibn Sard. And you see how they came out and fight, and they gave their lives. This is the legacy of the Tawwabun. And the legacy of those people who refused to accept the tyranny of the Banu Umayyah. And refused to remain silent. And refused to accept the fact that in Kufa, even after the demise of Al-Imam Abi Abdullah al-Hussein, the ladies and the children were made to parade around in the streets. One in particular, you all know this, that on the day of Ashura, when Al-Imam al-Hussein had left this world and the tents had been lit on the fires, Hamid ibn Muslim was one of the reporters in the army of the Banu Umayyah. When I say reporters, he was one of the men who stood on the side and he was taking notes on what is happening, who is fighting, who is saying what. And so he reported much of what has come to us, or a lot of what has come to us from the Arbab al-Maqatil, or the events of the battleground. He says, after the burning of the torches, after burning of the tents, I saw the ladies running in every direction. And I saw in particular one little girl running through the desert. And I saw that her clothes were burning with fire. Her clothes had caught onto fire and that they were burning. He says, I went after her and I came close to her and I tried to put the fire out. She turned to me and she said to me, Ya Sheikh, anta lana am alayna? Are you with us, O Sheikh, or are you against us? Who are you with? The man, Hamid ibn Muslim, he says, Ya bunayya, ana la lakum wa la alaykum. I am not with you. I am not against you either. But if you have a need, I will fulfill that need for you. The little girl, she says, إِذَنْ يَا شَيْخ دُلَّنِي إِلَىٰ دَرْبِ النَّجَافِ. tell me how to get to Najaf. Where is the road that leads to Najaf? They say, Hamid ibn Muslim, he says to her, Ya Bunayya, darb al-Najaf ba'id alayki. The road to Najaf is very far for you. You cannot go there. You cannot walk that distance. He says to her, Ya Bunayya, why do you want to go to Najaf? Why? What is the reason? She says to him that I want to go to Najaf because I want to see my grandfather Ali. I want to go to my master Ali, my grandfather, to complain to him what has been done to us, what has happened to us. They say that Hamid ibn Muslim, he says to Sukaina bint al-Husayn, Ya Bunayya darb al-Najaf ba'id alayki, you cannot go that far. She says to him, Idhan ya Sheikh, dullani ila masra'i abi Abdullah al-Husayn. Tell me how to get to the place where Imam Hussein was last fighting. Where was Hussein last on the battlefield? Just tell me, where was his last stand? Where was it that he was fighting in the last moments? Point that place out to me. Hamid ibn Muslim tells her how to get there. And this little girl, she runs. She runs to the chest of her father. That chest on which that she used to sleep all the time. That chest on which she used to always rest. And now, weeks later, where does she find herself? She finds herself in the Khareba. Sukaina bint al-Husayn with the other prisoners is in the prisons of Sham in Damascus. In the darkness of those days, some of the reports they say that Sukaina bint al-Husayn, aywa Husayna, aywa ghariba. Sukaina bint al-Husayn in the prison. It is reported in the darkness of that prison that she saw a dream in which she saw a lady coming towards her. She went to that lady in the dream. She said to her, who are you? That lady, she said to her, that I am Hawa Umm al-Bashar. I am Hawa, the mother of all of humanity. It is as if she saw in her dream another lady coming to her. She says to her, this second lady, that who are you? The lady, she says to Sukaina bint al-Husayn, Ana Maryam Umm Isa alayhi salam. I am Maryam, the mother of Isa alayhi salam, the mother of Jesus. She says, I ran again. I came to another lady who was coming towards me. I said to her, that who are you? Why are you coming here? She says that the lady, she answered me and she said, Ya Sukaina, I am Asiya bint Muzahim. I am Asiya, the wife of Fir'aun. I have come here for you. Finally, Sukaina bint al-Husayn, she looks and she sees another lady coming towards her. She is covered in all black. She is walking towards Sukaina bint al-Husayn. Sukaina, she says, as if she says, that this is my mother, Fatima al-Zahra. I see her coming towards me. She says, Ya Umma, Ya Umma, لقد قتلوا والدي الحسين لقد ايتموني وانا بعد طفله. My mother, oh Fatima, they killed my father al-Hussein. My mother, oh Fatima, they made me they made me an orphan and I am still so young. ويا أمة ما وجدنا بعد والدي الحسين إلا
ضرب السياط من ابن زياد. All we found after our father Al-Hussein left from this world are the whips cracking on our body. The Sheikh says, in my dream, Fatima Zahra, she says, "Kufi abnaya ya Sukaina, laqad ahraqti qalbi." My daughter, O Sukaina, stop telling me, stop recounting this to me. You have burnt my heart. How can I? وسيعلم الذين ظلموا آل محمد أي منقلب ينقلبون والعاقبة للمتقين إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون اللهم إنا نسألك وندعوك ونقسم عليك بحق الزهراء وأبيها وبعلها وبنيها والسر المستودع فيها لعن الله ظالميها اللهم شافي كل مريض اللهم رد كل غريب اللهم فك كل أسير اللهم غير سوء حالنا بحسن حالك يا كريم اللهم وفقنا لمراضيك وجنبنا معاصي وثبت أقدامنا على صراطك المستقيم وخذ بأيدينا إليك يا أرحم الراحمين وفرج عنا يا الله فرجا عاجلا قريبا كلمح البصر هو أقرب من ذلك وافرغ علينا صبرا وتوفنا مسلمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وآله الطيبين الطاهرين.